Thanks for coming after lunch. Thanks, Kiran, for the slot right after lunch. All right, so the next 30 minutes that I have with you is I have a talk which actually tries to look at two options, basically graphics on the web, predominantly Canvas and SVG. So I am trying to do a talk which I named Canvas and SVG, which way do I go? So it is really not an apple to apples comparison talk. So I have a little bit of a bias towards doing stuff in SVG. So don't be surprised if we actually have a little more going towards SVG, but I'm going to compensate that by actually sitting worse than Canvas. So that is the talk. I have kept it pretty light. We can keep it interactive. I have a few demos to show, and I also have some bit of beginner intermediate kind of stuff covered there. So before I get started, I just want to take a quick stab on who is doing Canvas stuff in this room already. One person, two, three. Right. How many of us are doing SVG here? Right. Not a whole lot of us. So I think my content structure would be useful for you guys. I'm trying to keep it as democratic as possible, keep it basic upwards, and let's see how far we get in the next 30 minutes. Yeah? So, sorry. My name is Harish. I'm the web and open standards guy for Adobe in this region. So I run the evangelism team for Adobe for the Southeast Asia region. So that's my job. I also have an afterlife as a musician. I play for a band called Agam. And I'm a nice guy. It's important to know because even if the talking makes sense, you don't like it. Right. Okay. So let's quickly set a context here. So I mean, talking about graphics on the web, we have come a long way. Okay? We started with the whole thing where everything was actually an image. Then we actually moved to the GIF animations, then Flash. Then we started using SVG and then Canvas. We have come a full long distance right now. But this talk predominantly tries to focus on two most up-to-date modern ways of doing graphics on the web. So let us actually look at what is the current web graphics model. So web graphics models are two, okay. The first one is a declarative model of doing graphics. How does it know what declarative programming is? How do you write this table, right? You write tags. So again, going back to the declarative model, which is being able to write tags to actually define the UI, right? So, and the other model is working with pixels, which is called the imperative program model. So basically, look at it this way. So if you're given a small little rectangle, if you're actually drawing pixels onto it, that is typically dealing with pixels. You can control every single pixel that you access. That's what the model Canvas on the web tries to access. It will give you a rectangular drawing surface, and you can actually draw colored pixels onto it. Right? While in HTML, everybody writes HTML here, right? So HTML, we have tags. Right? Every tag is indicative of some action. Like, you know, it could be UI, it could be like semantic tags, but what it ideally is, it's a declarative programming model where you have access to individual elements that you're programming, which is actually part of the talk. So SVG actually follows a principle of declarative graphics. So you can actually define something like a G, then say a circle, then say a rectangle, then say a path, and then it actually pulls out a graphic. While in Canvas, all you would do is draw those pixels on a rectangular area. So this is the difference, primary difference between the two ways we are comparing. The first way is working with pixels on a given rectangular surface, which is the imperative graphics model. The other one is a declarative model where every graphic element that you're working with has an appropriate tag in it. Right, let's quickly look at an example. It's a simple graphic which is running on the browser. Now, quick question to wake yourself. How many circles do you see?
Five.
Did they serve beer for lunch? You see four circles. But, correct, but there are only two. It's a circle with a stroke. Instead of having four circles, we have two circles with a stroke. So this is an SVG graph. You Okay, perfect, thank you. Okay, stack up, sir. That's how it should have ideally looked like. So this was my previous slide, just that I wanted to suggest two models that I mentioned. So you have the canvas way of doing things, and you have the SVG way of doing things. It's pretty self-explanatory. I'm not going to go back and spend a lot of time on it. It is just for you to sort of make out what these two program models mean. Moving on. So we saw this. Let us just quickly look at what making a circle like this would entail in SVG. I'm not going to code this, I already coded this up. I'm going to show you what that code looks like. Yeah, just give me a second. Can you see it at the back?
Yeah,
better? So I have an SVG, I'm specifying a width of 600 and 400, a view box, and then I'm saying a circle, which is of radius 175, a stroke, stroke width, a fill, and another circle. So if you can see that the width is actually 50 pixels, that's what gave you the illusion of four circles. While the circle has a very thick outer stroke and it actually fits constantly, it actually gives you the illusion that it's actually four circles. But this is what I mean by calling it a declarative way of doing a graph. Right, I will move on and I will actually show you a canvas example in some time, but this is right now we are focusing on SVG. This is how you actually do a simple circle. Right? Now let's quickly look at how these graphics are rendered. Right? It's not a file, it's not a PNG, it's not a JPG, it's actually like a format, it's actually rendered on the processor. So the following types are rendered for you: shapes, text, pictures, right? A combination of all. And sometimes, you know, you can actually have mixed match situations of, you know, these things going. I mean, you can have SVG within the context of canvas and things like that. We're not going to touch upon this, but in a nutshell, this is what gets rendered, right? On your browser. In declarative drawing, your rendering is calculated based on the values. It's actually extrapolated and calculated based on the values that you provided to your individual graphic elements. Like you make a circle and say its width is 200, height is 400, the radii is so and so. At runtime, it will be actually introspected as tags one after the other, and then it will be rendered. So all the values that is required for computing what should be drawn on your screen is actually based on the properties and values that you set for the individual SVG objects that you have. Also, the thing to remember is that the tags are executed one after the other. So if you actually declare a circle and I declare a circle, the first circle is declared rendered first, followed by the second. So if you want to put one over the other, always make sure that you're putting the one which needs to come on top is always declared second. Yeah? In terms of canvas, it has got a context, which is the 2D and the 3D context. It is available, I mean, once you create a canvas, you can get the get context call, you actually get an access to the context, and then you actually draw into the context. See, the most popular one is the 2D context, but if you're actually a WebGL programmer with some minimalistic support, you can do 3D stuff as well inside canvas. So, again, recapping, in canvas, you are given with the context, which is nothing but a pixel painting area, and you actually start drawing pixels into it. While in SVG, it is like your HTML job. You are actually adding graphic elements as tags and it is part of your job. What does that mean? Everybody's working with JavaScript here, isn't all of us? So anybody, the people who are working with Canvas, a question to you. How easy is to do actually events on things that you add onto your Canvas? Did somebody say difficult?
Yes.
Without a framework, I will not do it. I have better things to do in life. My brain goes into kebab mode when I do that. So I actually put an ESLJS framework on top and I start working with objects and the canvas. The canvas only gives you event access at a macro level, at the canvas level, but the stuff that you're adding onto the canvas, it is really, really hard to do eventing on it. See, by eventing, what I mean, you have a circle. When I click the circle, I want the circle to fly. In old flash sort of thinking. Or like you have a monkey image and you click it, it has to jump. And you want to do it in canvas, it's quite a pain in the ass. But considering SVG is similar to DOM and it is inherently eventable, it becomes much easier for you to actually attach events to SVG. Mind you, you can attach events to objects that you add to a canvas. I'm not saying it's not. It is just that it is actually a little harder. At the face of it, it's actually harder than how we do it in SVG. Right? I just said it. Object level events are hard to do. It needs frameworks.
What's the framework
you mentioned? ECLJS, just one of them. You don't have to necessarily use it. It's a framework which I'm very fond of, and the guy who wrote it is actually an old friend of mine. So both reasons put together, I sort of use it. That's why. So I'm going to show you a small little demo of what we call as pointer events in SVG. Any guesses in terms of what pointer events are? Anybody who's done SVG? Yes. So yes, it's of course mouse or touch, but pointer events actually allow you to actually track which particular section of an SVG that you are actually interacting on, right? So SVG has the following, right? It's got path, it's got fill, right? It's got the outer and the inner portions in case of a concentric circle. So the pointer events will actually help you track which particular region of a particular SVG graphic are you acting on. So there's a demo of that. I'm going to just show you that demo that will give you a clear picture of what pointer events are. Can you see it at the back?
Yeah.
Right. So you can see the events here: visible painted, visible fill, visible stroke, painted, visible fill, stroke, and all. See, these are available pointer events in SVG. So when we can just see, whenever I'm going to act on one of these things, it will animate this text below to show you whether that event was triggered or not. That's how this demo is structured. So visible painted, click anywhere, it's all painted, ain't it? The whole graphic is actually drawn, so we are clicking anywhere, it's actually painted region. So the pointer event visible painted fires, right? Visible fill. So if I click on the stroke, nothing happens. If I click on fill, it triggers an animation. The animation is nothing per se. I will show you how to do animations this week. That's my next one. But this is about the events that you need to keep in mind. The next one is visible stroke. You click on the stroke, it will fire. You click on the fill, it would not. So I'm not going to run the whole thing, but you get the picture. So these are the events to kind of keep track if you're actually acting upon. These are the point events that SVG sort of lets you use. Let us now, I'll show you the code. This is a small snippet of the same demo. We can look at. There is a circle with ID visible painted and point events visible painted. So I'm just doing a simple animate. When you are clicking this, it just begins the animation, and there's a text below. When visible painted dot click, that animation triggers. It's actually fairly straightforward. You can actually read through the model. So there's a circle, it has got an ID called visible painted. Yeah. And then I have defined an animate for that one, which is actually the one that changes the opacity. If you click in the middle, you see that it kind of becomes white and comes back. And then there is a text which is at the bottom, which I'm just circling. That is triggered when the visible painted is clicked. See, this syntax I'll touch upon in a short while, in the next 5 minutes, as to how you can do declarative animations in SVG. But it's important to know how you can use the pointer events. This is a problem in Canvas. There's no direct way of doing animations on Canvas. See, you will have to actually use your own mechanisms to actually be able to paint things on a canvas in a timed fashion. It could be done in the old-fashioned, set interval, set timeout way, or the more modern browser frame rate ways. That's really a call. But there's no direct way of actually doing canvas. So that's where again a framework called Create.js, it's part of the Create.js library, to which even ECLJS belongs, that comes handy. But when we look at declarative animations is important in this SVG. That would typically mean, do you know what an SMIL is?
Never mind, it's
nothing but a small snippet of XML, like thingy, which actually lets you define properties and styles and a bunch of things. So SVG actually lets you do declarative animations. Now you can actually add tags to define animation. If you saw my previous example, you could see a small snippet of that. But I have a much nicer demo of that, which I'm going to spend some time on. So, anybody knows what a shape tween is? Ever? It's a very flash terminology. I don't know what you call it. It's actually nothing but a morphing. You actually take one shape and you actually morph it into another shape. So I have a small little demo to show how you can do morphing using SVG. So, that's an SVG graphic. So this cross, if I click it, it becomes a tick. Right? And by morphing, it is not that it changes to a tick. Right? It has to morph into a tick. It has to animate and morph into a tick. Let's see if it works. Right? You wouldn't, there is really no, it's actually a fairly intense piece of SVG. I didn't hand code it, I used Illustrator for it. There's a tool called Adobe Illustrator which actually helps you create vector graphics pretty easily. But what is interesting to see here is that from the generated SVG, you can actually create an animation like this. I have a simple demo of this. But before I go into that,
can I ask you, will you use Illustrator?
That's what I'm going to come to. This is not an Illustrator session. But you know, when you're doing SVG, SVG has something called path. Right, you know, when you're actually making a non-standard geometric shape, what you actually create is an SVG path. So to be able to do a morph, like what I have demonstrated here, what you need to remember is the number of path points between the first shape and the morphed shape has to be equal. See, if you have X path points in shape A, you need to have X path points in shape B. That is when you can animate from shape A to shape B. See, animate is actually a tag. And now if the question is specifically about how to do create SVG. So what I do is you actually draw a path in Illustrator. And there's a tool called blending. I don't know if you've seen it. You can use the blending tool to actually create, it will actually extrapolate the paths for you. So use the same blending filter on the target shape, it will create the same path points for you and give two SVG tags. Then throw it and code this up. So coding this up is nothing. Let me show you. Okay, don't worry about all this, I hope everybody knows what the M and L and all that what means in SVG, right? It's a simple, your move to, line to sort of commands that you typically have in any kind of graphics program. If you're actually drawing, it is actually set as parameters inside a tag and that's what, but that's not the point. So if you see here, see I have a path called morph. This is actually my cross, which starts with M29.766. And I'm saying this one will start when the cross is clicked. So basically that shape is called cross. I click that, begin, and this is the tick. And start the animate when the tick is clicked. That's about it. So you actually get this from Illustrator. You simply say on click of that, go there, on click of that, go here. It's as simple as that. And just to make this demo a little reliable and video, because it's actually, the SVG's beauty is that it will actually draw empty spaces between the unpainted areas. So if you're drawing a cross on it, the cross is drawn. The bounding box is not drawn. Bounding box won't have any pixels. So just to prevent that, I added two rectangles and kind of filled them so that the click almost always receives anywhere you click on the cross. That's what you see in the code. Don't be so affected by the code, but it's pretty simple. You have to create like two paths from Illustrator or any of your favorite SVG generation program, and you can morph it by simply putting an animate directive. And give the attribute name and then just say two. Right? So this is done without any JavaScript, as you see. But now the question is, can I do the scripting-oriented way? Yes, there are frameworks for that. A lot of people that I spoke to here said they're all using Rafael.js for all their SVG work. 99% of the people whom I spoke to during lunch all said that they are all on Rafael.js. Some people are on T3 as well, some people are doing Paper.js. You're free to use micro frameworks which actually help you do stuff in a JavaScript-oriented way for SVG. But since I'm talking about SVG, it is the most honest way of showing how you can do animation in SVG is by actually showing how you can do it tutorial. Now, who is working with CSS transitions transforms here? Everybody. Do you like it? I love it. But you know, there's a small little problem that I face with CSS animations is that they are not synchronized. Can you do, can you out of the box do a synchronized animation in CSS? If you can, I'd like to be told, but I believe you cannot, because they are inherently parallelize and they just run. You call two CSS translations, they'll just run. You cannot say, after my X translation is over, trigger my Y. You cannot. See, that is the reason why I suddenly became a huge fan of SVG animations. I was doing a project, I was building impressionist objects. Most of my translation efforts internally I wanted to build with SVG. I didn't want to build them with CSS translations. Eventually they generate CSS, but I wanted to experiment with time dilation. So the way synchronized animations can be done in SVG is magical. See, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, you have to do nothing. You have to write so less code to actually figure out transition, time transition in SVG. It's best shown with a demo. Let me show you that. Yeah, it's a dumbass pendulum, but then I want to click this leftmost guy. He will sway, come and knock this, and by principle of physics, the guy on the right will sway. Correct? Because he's studying in school. Studies. No, so I want to show you that. So it's a simple piece of animation. Nothing too complex about it. But to see the code, that's where the difference is. I'll show it on my. I have a line, of course. I mean, deciphering this piece of code is nothing. That thing is actually a pendulum, so it naturally has a line, and then that gray circle. That is the graphic. That's what you see here: line, a circle, and another circle. The stroke is also a small, just to give the gradient perspective. Then I have just given an animate transform, and I'm saying type is rotate. Value 0 to 90 to 0 and will begin when part A is clicked. See, part A is an entire section. See, when you actually do SVG, you actually group them together. So you actually put a G tag, then you have the part, then you have the line, then you have the circle, and then you have the animate. So I'm saying when you click part A, begin this animation, and when this whole animation ends, see, similar to this begin event node, I have a end event. So when this ends, when part A, this animation, when raySphereAnim.end, I will say part B dot start, that animation dot start. See, that's what I'm doing over here. Code is a little involved, but see here. So this is the golden circle, this section, what I'm highlighting, that's the part B, right? So I am just asking that transformation, that animation to begin when the gray sphere animation has ended. See, that's exactly what you see in the demo, right? Yeah, so this is the part A click, ended, part B triggered. See, what you see over here is it's all declarative. There is no real code that you have. But you can actually do this with code. I mean, naturally, when you're actually building an application, you do not do it this way. But the beauty is, it actually gives you time, animation, and these are all vectors. Like, they're all vector graphics, and they are resolution independent. And it actually works so smoothly. It's Ion Pro. Works very smoothly. Sometimes even smoother than some of the CSS stuff that I'm doing. That is debatable. That's just probably my own illusion because I have a specific liking towards SVG, like I mentioned. Can I have 5 more minutes for question? Okay? Since I have time. Yeah, I think I'll have 5 minutes more material to cover this, okay? We just saw the timing and simulation demo. So, that is something which is... Word and frameworks. This is very important to know. So, whatever I showed you is to actually compare SVG and Canvas in bare-bone sort of structure, you know, what Canvas offers to you, like I mentioned. See, I am tending towards SVG more in this talk, but Between Canvas and SVG, there are a bunch of really great frameworks that abstract out most of this work that you're doing right now. So the frameworks that I would like to name for Canvas, I already named ESLJS. There is a rather lightweight library called Kinetic. I don't know if anybody is using it. It actually just gives you object access. It doesn't give you animations and stuff. That Kinetic is actually pretty nice and nifty. So I'll actually show you a simple demo that I built in Canvas using ESLJS. Let me just pull up that demo if somebody wants to. Yeah, so I mean, I'll tell you what impression this is in a while. Yeah. So this is a demo that I built using Canvas, which was inspired by the Google Zeitgeist experiment. If anybody has seen that, have you seen the googlezeitgeist.com site? They have a bunch of visualizations. So this is actually done using Canvas. It's pure HTML, JavaScript, CSS. This is a demo that I built. So it is on Canvas. You will not see a single line of HTML written for this. And similarly, this is actually, there's another demo that I built for. So that uses a combination of CSS and SVG. This is again inspired by the Zeitgeist experiment. So this is a combination of SVG images and regular HTML. So this does stuff like this. The idea is not mine, the implementation is. Yeah, so this is something I also built. I said it's a combination. So basically that some of the transform stuff is not SVG, some of the transform stuff is CSS. The moving objects, the moving parts, as you see, the gradients, the caps, the blues, the greens, the ones which actually grow, they are all SVG.
Can you affect SVG elements using CSS?
Not to a great deal, I know the support is patchy. You can do some bit, but you cannot do a whole lot. So I also built one more, which is, I built another demo which I'd like to show you. This is actually an application which was initially Flex. I just ported that to HTML. Again, some of the transitions and some of the assets that is used here is actually a combination of SVG. So I don't know if you've seen the Flex demo of this. Anybody seen the Flex demo of this? You guys would have seen. I might have presented it for you guys, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, so this is again another one which actually uses some bit of SVG. Do stuff like this. So these are all a couple of experiments that I've been doing to actually mix and match things. This also has, it's not entirely SVG, obviously it has HTML and JavaScript, but this is another example that I did, and of course. Right, so these demos I just wanted to, these are all posted in my blog, so you can actually go and take a look. So, right, now where am I? D3, Rafael.js, Paper.js, go check them. I don't have anything to show about these frameworks. They're all out there. People are already using them. It'll be interesting to see what you can do with them for the sake of time. Canvas and SVG both offer great capabilities for the web. You know, you can build stuff in Canvas, build in SVG. I have been doing both. I could show you a couple of demos. So both of them actually offer you great capabilities, but ability to do graphics iteratively and through scripting makes SVG more interesting for me, because working with a rectangular area of just dumb pixels is not always suitable for all sort of problems. See, there are specific situations where you should use Canvas because you want to have pixel level access, but you want to have high rendering, you want to do high performance stuff. There is a place for Canvas, but this is another XML based animation support, is a huge plus. This makes it very powerful for games, data visualization.
For example, do this on users.
Which one?
Pixel level access.
Do I have an example?
No, can I show you one?
Yeah, sure.
Go to newzealand.com.
Say that again?
Newzealand.com. The country New Zealand.
Okay. There you go.
It's completely Canvas powered site, it's not a game. this is called up.
Should I
take the website off?
The child?
Yeah.
You actually spoken to you before this start. I should have scored some points showing this demo.
So you guys see scroll down. Have you seen ro.me? Ro.me. Yeah.
Okay. I mean.
Even
okay, before you all make a judgment on me being this avid Canvas hater who's actually actively making propaganda against Canvas, I'm sorry, I'm not. I was merely mentioning that there is a use case for that. Like, you know, for most of the times, now, of course, there's a great example of how you can use Canvas to build something which is not a game and which is not a digitalization. Props to you for that. Thanks for showing this demo. And just reiterating, that was not my intent. But I, as a guy, as an engineer with personal likes and dislikes, I like the semantic aspect of SVG. I like the fact that it is DOM level. I like the fact that I can access individual parts of it rather than working only with pixels. And secondly, I also hold a little bit of grudge from my previous life as a Flash evangelist, where everybody used to say that no SEO optimization. I cannot even read the text from an SFB of movie. Can you read the text from the canvas? That you put on the canvas. So comparing apples against apples. Canvas is actually a nice variant for a plugin-free world. Then whatever you used to do with the plugin earlier, you can now do it without a plugin. But everything has its place. So sometimes I personally would not want that pendulum animation to be done using SLJs. It actually required 10 lines of markup. I would want it to be done that way. That's me. I'm not evangelizing. Okay, I'm evangelizing it, but you don't take my code. So that's what I was trying to say. So I mean, you can do kick-ass stuff with Canvas. Like if you just go to Grant Skinner's create.js page, he has some mind-blowing demos of what he has done with SLJs for all use cases from the Hello World to probably something as complex as like building a space shuttle. So my intent was not to tell that do not use Canvas, and this is a great example, thanks once again as to what you can do with the powers of Canvas. Once again shows as to how a nice plugin free open world can have this kind of great fidelity experiences. So that's a great thing. Not bad, I have 5 minutes and I was okay with time, isn't it? That's okay. Questions?
Is there any cross-browser issues in SVG?
Good question. Cross-browser? I wouldn't call it cross-browser issues. His question is there any cross-browser issues with SVG? I wouldn't call it cross-browser issue. SVG is a spec and different browsers implemented. Like, you know, it's an implementation question. So if you're using SVG, it will be a good idea to check which browser implements what feature of SVG to what extent. So to that extent, it is cross-browser compatible, but you also need to understand that different browser vendors have different prerogatives in terms of what features they want to implement first. So it would be good to look at them before that. Same with Canvas, actually. So most of Canvas 2D is supported all across. For Canvas 3D, you might have to check which browser is supporting and
so like for SVG used to be called like SVG had its own like some other vector name or like Raphael used to have SVG for like Chrome or Firefox and
right.
He specifically invented some other tab.
Right. I think it is still on. You can actually create.
Yeah,
sorry?
Yeah.
So he's saying you can output SVG specific to which browser platform that you're targeting. Like, you know, you can output SVG for Chrome, SVG for Android support, for example. Yes?
What's the drag and drop support on SVG? Can it be done with SVG?
It's down. What is the drag and drop support on SVG?
It's down.
Somebody has a question? Any more questions?
Hi, Monon.
Hi.
No more questions would save the next speaker some time. Go, sure. They're not giving that to you.
If I'm plotting some visualization, I'm going to put in the DOM elements for SVG. Is it better to use a canvas or better to use SVG? For a huge amount of.
Use your description, good question. See, flooding your DOM, whether it is SVG or whether it is HTML, actually. Ruining your DOM with way too many elements, especially with nesting, especially with whole lot of pixels being drawn into them, is terrible, whether you're doing SVG or not. So in that particular case, that's what I mean. So if you're actually plotting a million points into a candlestick chart or something like that, Raphael guys claim that they do it Kick-Ass. I'm not going to validate. I mean, they have optimizations of their own to actually probably do virtualization. See, virtualization is a way you actually control the number of DOM elements, and you actually recycle. Like you have 10 elements, and at one point in time you're showing 10, when you're actually scrolling to the next, you actually virtualize. There are multiple ways of DOM virtualization that is possible. You can implement your own. So microframers do claim they can do that, but if I was going a framework-free sort of approach, I would be skeptical to add way too many DOM elements, doing way too many things. See, even adding DOM is one thing. Attaching listeners to that, and those listeners actually doing more stuff is something more. So a cascade effect of that would actually cost you a very, very slow entry phase. And of course, if you are not a really good JavaScript programmer, you're going to have lurking objects. I have seen a lot of dynamic programmers generally randomly create objects, kind of attach listeners to DOM elements, and the DOM is kind of remote, but the listener is not, and things like that. So don't fall into that mess. If you actually know that your DOM is going to get flooded, virtualize it or look for options. That's right. But that's my suggestion. Of course, there would be umpteen ways of doing
it. I think it does happen actually. Like what you said, the DAW files, as they claim that they are like that, but a lot of libraries tend to have all that lurking.
Right. See, eventually, I mean, just a small little experience of mine, it was not specific to JavaScript, but I used to work in the Adobe Flex SDK. We have heard about Adobe Flex, it's a similar HTML like language to Flash. So I was building the data grid component, which had a virtualization support. And even today, I get threat mails from people as to how that feature has been released. Like, a lot of people are using it, like a large enterprise are using it. I myself have gone concerned for so many of them with the component. So like I said, you need to be watchful and cautious for your own use case in terms of what you want to do.
Well, large data points, Canvas actually generally works better because memory consumption is constant. So,
right.
Then, you know.
Yeah, because DOM inherently lets you write whatever you want, while Canvas actually puts a little more discretion in terms of what you can do and what you cannot do. So, right. Any more questions, sir? You can ask personal questions, don't be shy. All right. Okay. So, Vincent Hardy's presentations, a couple of demos are those. The folded hands is for Vincent Hardy. See, he's actually my guru in SVG. I have been working with him offline for the last 2 to 3 months, working on some CSS shaders, extension stuff. So go check Vincent Hardy's presentation. It is really hard to build a presentation which is better than Vincent's. So Vincent is your man if you want to go and do more stuff. SVGWOW.com, half of the contribution is also by Vincent. So Vincent is a principal scientist in Adobe. He works in San Francisco office. Great guy, very responsive. Vincent_Hardy on Twitter. So if you have questions on SVG, of course you can ask me. If you think, no, I don't want to ask you, I'll ask the man himself. Go ask Vincent.
What's your Twitter ID?
Huh? My Twitter ID?
Yeah.
Hang on, buddy. So beer, vodka, anything to be evening, drop me an email, or follow me on Twitter, or please follow me on GitHub. Makes me look good in the general context. And of course, I have a blog, which is xoram.com/tech. And follow me on Twitter and say hi whenever you get a chance. And please feel free to write me regarding anything pertaining to my job with respect to talk. And a last small word of pimping for my own good. This is an Impress.js presentation and created using a tool called Impressionist. Impressionist is a tool that I'm building to be able to create Impress.js presentations in a visual way. So the Impress.js framework is available at bata.github.com/impress.js, and my tool is free open source. It's on GitHub and open development. You can see it over there. If you guys have some free time after this talk, come look up me. I'll give you a demo of Impressionist because I don't want to take wrath from the HasGeek guys for shamelessly creeping my application in an Thanks, Kiran. I should have factored that in the first part of the talk. So, thank you very much, and thanks for coming in this afternoon and not sleeping, and actually putting a nice brave face for my talk and see how it's doing. Yeah, the pre-talk form is also the other form, and there's an option called plus one.